Artifacts. They are the main reason for the stalker's interest in the zone, and they can make you rich. But have you ever wondered, why are these anomalous objects so valuable? What are they used for in the world outside of the zone? And why stalkers are almost never seen using them? Hello stalkers, and welcome to the Anomalous Dugout. In this video, we will answer these questions by uncovering the lore behind the artifacts. Before we start, let me remind you that I have already done a few explanation videos about artifacts, so if you are interested, be sure to check them out. Links in the description. And now let's take a look at the lore we have about artifacts. Obviously, the main reason for the high value of artifacts is their unique properties. Not only are these objects usually made out of strange and unknown materials, but they also provide special abilities to their owner, such as increased stamina and vitality, a protective field that sways incoming bullets, and much more. Yet, most artifacts also possess negative properties, most notably radiations, which is probably why stalkers prefer to sell them rather than to use them. To begin with, I would like to present the different types of artifacts that can be found in the games. You have probably noticed that the artifacts in Shadow of Chernobyl are very different from those in Clear Sky and Call of Pripyat. In the first game, artifacts could be found laying around without the need to use a detector. Some of them were radioactive, but they also had many other negative properties. Meanwhile, in Clear Sky and Call of Pripyat, artifacts were almost exclusively found inside anomaly clusters and required a detector to appear. Also, almost all of these artifacts had radioactivity as their side effect. So, how do we explain these differences? Well, there is no official answer, but I have my own theory that I shared in details in an older video. Basically, I believe that the invisible artifacts from Clear Sky and Call of Pripyat are formed during emissions, while the visible artifacts from Shadow of Chernobyl are formed over time in anomalies, in the absence of emissions. Regardless, there are a few special artifacts that distinguish themselves from the others. The first two are known as half artifacts. They are the Altered Will and the Altered Insulator. These are simple objects who started to transform into artifacts under the influence of anomalies. However, they seem to be both devoid of useful properties while being highly radioactive. Then there is the anomalous plant. This plant was located in a grove overtaken by chemical anomalies. While the plant is interesting for the scientists, it does not have any special properties whatsoever. Another artifact without visible properties is the Scarlet Flower. It is unknown where this object can be found, as it is looted from a corpse, and it has the same appearance as the Flash artifact. If the legends are true, the Scarlet Flower's only power is to seduce women, making it a precious asset for a stalker looking for a date. Finally, we get to the good stuff, some of the most powerful artifacts in the zone. Here we have the compass, a very rare artifact said to be found in the infamous space anomaly, providing with a number of benefits. And there we have the Heart of the Oasis, a unique plant artifact created in the legendary Oasis. Truly a wonderful object. Alright, now that the odd artifacts have been presented, let's dive deeper into the lore. The first source of information about these objects are their descriptions themselves. We won't go through all the descriptions, since I already did that in previous videos. However, there are still some interesting things to point out. First of all, we learn that some artifacts do not activate by themselves, and that the user has to know how to handle the artifact properly to use its powers. For example, the thorn has to pierce the user's body with its spikes to function, removing radioactive particles at the cost of a loss of blood. There is also the shell that has to be kept in constant contact with the body to manifest its stimulating effect. Then there are artifacts that appear to be much more complicated to use. One of them is the moonlight, which apparently has to be fine-tuned by stalkers in order to resonate in opposite phase with psi emissions, effectively neutralizing them. Unfortunately, I have no idea how this fine-tuning works. Another example is the extremely rare compass, which is said to be able to find safe path in anomalies. According to its description, only a few know how to use it, one of them being the Forester. Then we learn about some of the most popular artifacts that are used by stalkers. Anti-radiation artifacts, such as the bubble, are in great demand, and it's not that hard to understand why. Moreover, anti-gravity artifacts, like the Night Star, Gravy, and Goldfish, are also said to be used a lot by stalkers to reduce the weight of their backpacks. We can even find the body of a dead stalker owning one of these in the basement under Zaton. Finally, endurance artifacts, like the battery, also seem to be of value to stalkers. Honestly, I'm not surprised that the most popular artifacts within the zone are anti-rads, anti-grav, and endurance, as the combination of the three will basically give you immunity to radiations and superhuman strength. Moving on, we have to talk about the use of artifacts in the outside world, the Big Land, as they call it. Obviously, the government, the military, and the scientists are very interested in artifacts. However, they are not the only ones. Some wealthy people are simply artifact collectors, who wish to own the strange objects for their rarity and their beauty. Artifacts such as the Soul and the Flash appear to be good candidates for these collectors. Then, some artifacts are used in the field of medicine. For example, the jellyfish is said to be used in very rare cases to treat radiation sickness outside of the zone. The meat chunk is also the target of artifact orders from both Sidorovich and Barkeep. The first for use in a clinic, and the second for padres who could use the artifact to create healing miracles. Sidorovich also reveals that some artifacts are used to make jewels, such as the stone flower. According to him, the ladies also wear pseudo-dog's fur in the winter, so why not jewels made out of artifacts? I'm not even surprised at this point. But still, the most important buyers of artifacts remain the military and the scientists. Both these groups are connected, since they work for the government, and they share a common interest for the Night Star artifact. Sidorovich says that the army is working on some protection using this artifact, while Barkeep explains that it is the scientists who design the new military equipment. This artifact hunt is even rewarded by a soldier suit, confirming that the order came from the army. Now let's see what else those eggheads can do with artifacts. According to Professor Sakharov, anti-gravitational objects, such as the gravity, will help to make great progress in the understanding of anti-gravitation, allowing the development of anti-grav engines and possibly the conquest of space. Of course, we are not at this point quite yet, but it might only be a matter of time. Furthermore, the mysteries of time and space could also be within our reach by studying the artifacts born in the vortex anomaly, like the jellyfish. Some theories claim that the vortex squeezes time itself, and the professor is determined to show what he's capable of discovering while working in the field. Little does he know, teleportation already exists. Anyway, the scientists also seem to study less exciting subjects, such as the thermal properties of artifacts, like the fireball. From this task, we also learn that Sakharov's team has been able to create an artifact in laboratory conditions, and not just any artifact, but an extremely rare pellicle. While I am not entirely sure what the sentence "in laboratory conditions" means in this context, the professor is extremely proud of this achievement and believes that it could win him a Nobel Prize. In fact, we have a few other references to such experiments. In the description of the mammoth beads, it is written that scientists can't figure out how to create this artifact in laboratory conditions. Something similar is said about the urchin, where it is mentioned that Sakharov was the one to explain all of this in his fundamental work titled "Ionization and Polarization of the Components of Rare Artifacts." Damn, I wish I could read his papers. Coming back to the sentence, "created in laboratory conditions," it is possible that this is a reference to a cut concept called artifact merging, where the player would be able to create his own artifacts via a special device by using other artifacts and items as ingredients in merging recipes. Basically, the device would recreate the conditions typically seen in anomalies, in the goal of artificially generating artifacts. Even though this idea was cut, I would not be surprised if Sakharov built a machine similar to that. In another artifact hunt given by the professor, we learn that the urchin is used to create a special lotion that is applied to protective suits. This is how the SSP-99 series, and possibly the Seva suits, get their incredible radioactive protection value. In Shadow of Chernobyl, it is also possible to find three unique bodysuits that are gifted with the ability to heal the user over time. While the jacket gained this property by spending a lot of time in an anomaly, and Ghost suit remains a mystery, we do know that the healing barrel is saturated with a special lotion, so I would not be surprised if this lotion was also made using artifacts. Moreover, in the description of some armors, we can see that the bulletproof vest is often complemented by something called an anomalous suppression system, or anomalous protection vest. My theory is that such words describe a layer of the armor which is crafted using artifact lotions or something similar, providing increased survivability against anomalies. And if artifacts can be utilized to upgrade protection, they are also used to improve weaponry. Indeed, we know of at least two shotguns called combat chasers that have been modified using a piece of the gravy artifact. The fragment, placed in the barrel, allows bullets to exit the gun faster. Now, when we think about futuristic weapons in the zone, the Gauss rifle instantly comes to mind. However, it does not use artifacts to shoot, at least not directly. In principle, The Gauss gun functions with electromagnets that were designed before the zone even came to be. The problem is that a large quantity of energy is required to power the weapon, and that's where artifacts enter into play. The latest model of batteries for the Gauss rifle was manufactured using fragments of the flash artifact, which provide an enormous amount of energy storage. While this technology was developed by the scientists working in the X-Labs, Professor Sakharov is also aware of the energetic potential of electro-artifacts. According to him, the most efficient artifact to produce electricity is the moonlight, which is not surprising considering that it is one of the rarest and most powerful Andron's artifacts. So now it is confirmed that energy can be produced using artifacts. And if the ecologists are able to do it, you bet that the scientists working in X-Labs knew how to do it as well, and probably much better, since they had more time to study the zone. Therefore, it is definitely possible that the people behind the secret experiments in the zone created machines to power their laboratories using artifacts. This could explain how systems such as the Psi emitter in Lab X16 or the antennas of the Brain Scorcher continued to work even after being abandoned. But this is a subject for another video, so we will come back to it another time. To finish with the topic of artifacts, I want to answer this question. Why so few stalkers use artifacts for their benefits? I mean, almost no stalker keeps artifacts on him, they just sell them immediately. As we said already, the various negative effects are probably one of the reasons. The opportunity of instantly making a lot of hard cash is also a factor. Besides, moving around with artifacts can be dangerous, as it can attract unwanted attention from bandits and other untrustworthy individuals. But still, I think there is another reason for the fear of using artifacts, despite their amazing properties. You see, my theory is that artifacts have a less known side effect, which is to slowly mutate your body over prolonged use. This fact is hinted at in some descriptions. For example, the meat chunk is said to regenerate cells, but the newly born cells are less resistant, as if they were different. Even more striking, scientists claim that the Colobok interacts with the user's genetic code. These statements should not be taken lightly, as the long-term effects of artifacts on human health are currently unknown. What if some of the mutants are actually former stalkers who used artifacts too much and became anomalous themselves? Unfortunately, we can only speculate for now, as the artifacts continue to hide most of their secrets, and will surely puzzle scientists for decades to come. With that said, I think it is time to end this video. Make sure to share your thoughts in the comments below, as I will read all of them. Thank you for watching, stalkers, and goodbye.